journey. So we started with part one last time, and it was the early years up to middle school. So now we're gonna jump over to high school, all the way up to where I am now as a dancer, what that journey has been like, all of that good stuff. So thank you for tuning in so far. I hope that you enjoy part two, so stay tuned. Yeah. So moving over to high school. High school was very rough. That's all I'm gonna say. High school was very rough. So ninth grade year, and actually to back up just a little bit, so I did both dance and band in middle school as well, and that's probably why we couldn't afford to put me in dance classes. I was already in too much stuff. But anyway, so I was in dance and band in middle school, and so I played snare drum, and I was chopping, still chopping as a matter of fact, but was chopping. So did that in middle school. But anyway, going over to high school, I kind of put dance down for a little while, and that is kind of a regret a little bit there, putting it down for that year. But I just did marching band for ninth grade year. That was a pretty rough year transitioning from middle school to high school. But like I said, that, and this is before I really knew that it was the Holy Spirit. I always, you know, believed in God, grew up in church and stuff like that, but never really had a full understanding of the Holy Spirit and how he speaks to us. So that tugging, nagging kind of feeling started to come back toward the end of ninth grade year. And so, just to give a little bit of background about our middle school and high school. So they were right across the street from each other. So once you leave from middle school, you go across the street to high school, like literally across the street. So that's how it was. So we had one band director over at the middle school, another one at the high school. And so I told him, band director, like, I want to try out for dance line. He'd never seen me dance. He knew my sister because he taught, he was the band director at that high school when she was in high school. He'd seen her dance. He'd never seen me dance. He only knew that I played an instrument. He was like, girl, you don't need to get off that snare drum. You don't need to get off that snare drum. You don't need to be dancing. You can't dance. I was like, oh, doubt. Okay, don't doubt me like that. Okay. So proved him wrong. Tried out for dance line. Made it. Made the dance team. All that good stuff. But anyway, just going back to how the Holy Spirit was speaking to me. Just that feeling just wouldn't go away. I've never been able to put dance down completely. So I went ahead and followed that nudge and that tugging on my spirit to start back dancing again. So like I said, tried out, made the team. It was kind of a rough thing for me. Like I said, high school was rough overall. It was a lot going on. My mom was kind of in and out of the hospital. And just to be, I'm going to be open and transparent here on this channel as well. My mother, she struggled with mental health issues. She had bipolar depression, and she also suffered from schizophrenia as well. So she had episodes and things like that. And this was one of those times from like ninth grade to 10th grade when it was really, really bad, when she was in and out of the psych ward, all that good stuff. So I danced that year. Like I said, it was kind of rough. I loved it. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed the dancing, but there were a lot of things that just didn't sit well with me as far as attitudes. I'm a very chill person. I don't really do attitudes. I don't do drama. Not my scene. I don't do that. But yeah, so after that year, and I also really loved playing my snare drum as well. I was talented at it. I was really good at it. And so I was like, well, I have the option to kind of put this down for a while and pick up something else, because I had both. So, and because of that struggle and because I didn't really enjoy it personally, just because of some of the drama and all the trouble we were in that year on dance line, I put it down after that year and I went back to being in the band for the remainder of high school, from, what was that, 11th grade, 12th grade. And then, of course, after that year, that nudging, tugging, pulling, feeling from the Holy Spirit kind of came back, because I started watching the dance team and they had transitioned over to a new choreographer for that next year. And I'm looking at this choreography like, man, this is some dope choreography. I should have stayed. I wish I was doing this choreography, because it was some really good changes that were made for that next year. It just seemed to be more cohesive. I'm like, I should have stayed, but I didn't. I let the drama and all that stuff get in my head, and the negativity. Anyway, everything happens for a reason. Moving forward, get to senior year. I kind of wanted to try out again that 12th grade year, but I'm like, oh, this is my last year. I kind of want to try other things. I almost did track at one point. I ended up being track manager, but never did track. I kind of wanted to explore some different things. Never did, just kind of stuck with the band. So we get to the end of senior year, y'all. Here goes that nudging, tugging, nagging feeling from the Holy Spirit again. I'm like, I want to dance again. I want to dance. So we're at that point in senior year where everybody's stressed out trying to figure out what college am I going to, how am I going to pay for it, testing, ACTs, SATs, if you had to take SATs to get into college. I don't think we had to take SATs. We only did ACT. But anyway, so it's that point of senior year. And yeah, so I'm running around doing all this stuff, trying to prepare for college. One thing that I did do my senior year, like I said, I was trying to just kind of explore some different things outside of band. So I did debutante. And if you know what a debutante is, it's bourgeoisie, honey. It's bourgeoisie. Yeah. I was a debutante, though. But thankfully, I did, because it helped me open up my horizons a little bit more when it came to college. So the sister program, I don't really know what you call it. I'm gonna have to look that up and insert it somewhere in the video. But basically, the college that was connected to our specific location or chapter of the debutante society was Alabama A&M University. So once it came to the end of that year from being a debutante, we did the debutante ball and all of that good stuff. We had a good time. But I really started thinking about going to Alabama A&M. And from being a debutante, I think they gave every girl that was a debutante from that class some scholarship money to go to Alabama A&M. And so I actually still have my certificate. I'm going to show it. To the scholarship we got from Alabama A&M from being a debutante. Here is my certificate. And y'all about to get my full name. Don't y'all... Listen, but I spelled it wrong on this one. It's okay. So this was my certificate. This ring light is super duper bright. But this is it. We got quite a bit of money. I think it was like per semester, basically, but it was over the course of the entire 4 years that you anticipate to be there. But that was it. That was my scholarship. And then we had a little another certificate for completing debutante. This got my whole name on it. Jesus. First, middle, and last night. Jesus. Okay. But yes, this is my certificate for being a debutante. All right. But yeah, outside of A&M, another college that I wanted to go to was Clark Atlanta University. And like I said, that nudging, tugging feeling came back to dance. I have always loved Clark Atlanta University Essence Dance Team. That was my number one draft pick when it came to dancing. I wanted to be a Clark Atlanta Essence dancer. Hear me. Hear me. I wanted to be a Clark Atlanta Essence dancer, but I never ended up applying to Clark Atlanta. I don't know. I don't really remember what the reason was. I never just ended up applying. I think I kind of got discouraged and just never thought, oh, maybe if I go, I'll be too far away from home. I think a lot of that stuff kind of got in my head. So I never applied, never went. But if I could go back, Clark Atlanta. Okay. But anyway, I basically kind of ended up choosing to go to Alabama A&M kind of based on this scholarship. Because like I said, it opened my mind a little bit more, because I was dead set on Clark Atlanta. I wasn't looking at no other school. I'm in Tuscaloosa now, so I ain't looking at the UA. I ain't thinking about going to Birmingham, the UAB, which I ended up going and graduating from. Shout out Blazers. But I wasn't looking at no other school. I had my heart and my mind and my soul said Oak Clark, Atlanta, and didn't even end up applying. But anyway, so ended up applying for to Alabama A&M, got in. Used some of that scholarship. Going back to the dance thing. So getting ready, college prep, all that good stuff. I ended up trying out for Alabama A&M Dancing Divas. Shout out to the Dancing Divas. I love Dancing Divas. They've always been, they've always had a special place in my heart because when I was going off to college, that was, you know, everything to me. I wanted to dance. So I tried out, didn't make it. I'll talk about that in a second. That nudging, tugging feeling kind of came back to want to dance. So I tried out for them. I didn't make it, and it crushed me a little bit, just a little bit, not too much. I had regained a lot of that passion for dance back so much. I didn't care that I didn't make it. I was like, I can either always try out again, like go work for the technique, because I really feel like that was why, or part of why I didn't make Dancing Divas. In my opinion, I just did not have enough of the technique. And like I said, going back to when I was younger, we didn't have the money to put me in dance classes and things like that. So I kind of had to learn along the way. So I only had what I call spot technique, just learning here and there from being on dance teams and things like that, and picking up on terminology, things like that. So in my opinion, I feel like that's why I didn't make it. I just didn't have enough of the technique that they were looking for. When I went in there, it was intimidating. There were a lot of girls in there that had the technique. They had been probably dancing since 3, 4, 5 years old.
Yeah.
So, but I made it through tryouts. It, like I said, it was intimidating. It was challenging because I didn't have a lot of the technique. And I was coming off of an injury that I sustained in middle school. I was practicing my splits, went down too hard while stretching, tore the hamstring. And I actually still deal with that injury to this day. It still hurts a little bit doing certain things, kicks, leaps, things like that. But I make it through, you know. But yeah, so like I said, tried out for them, didn't make it. And my dad was there and he's waiting outside. He's like, so did you make it? Did you make it? I'm like, no, I didn't make it. He's like, what?
Didn't make it, Dad. Didn't make it.
But yeah, didn't make that team. And so I thought I was going to put it down, but it was just something in me. I couldn't let it go. So went back home to Tuscaloosa. And this is how much the passion for dance in me is. I did not go to my senior prom. I skipped my senior prom to audition for Dancing Divas and didn't make it and didn't care that I missed prom. Did not care. That was my goal. That was my passion. I knew I was going to Alabama A&M. I had already gotten accepted to the school. I just needed to go try out and, you know, make the team. Didn't make it. It didn't matter. So anyway, going back, went back home to Tuscaloosa. I still wanted to dance and I'm like, there's gotta be a way I can still dance in college. And there's a guy that I was went to high school with. He told me about one of his friends that went to our church. I didn't know her at the time. So he was like, let me introduce you to Ashley. And he was like, just go talk to her. She's on a dance team at A&M. It's not Dancing Divas. It was called Maroon Mirage. I'm not even sure if Maroon Mirage is still around or if it still exists, but I'm going to have to look that up. I'll look that up. But yeah, she was on a team called Maroon Mirage at Alabama A&M. So she had already been at A&M for a year already because she's a year ahead of me. And she was dancing on this team. He was like, go talk to her. I know that she dances and she's really good and she can tell you the process and all that stuff. So we all went to this, like I said, we all went to the same church, Cornerstone Baptist Church, Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Yeah. But went to church that following Sunday after he told me to go talk to her. So I went up and talked to her. I was like, hey, such and such told me to come and talk to you about the dance team and how tryouts go and winter tryouts and what do I need to do to prepare and all that good stuff. So little did I know, once I talked to her, and I talked to her in the nick of time too, and I feel like this was God as well. He kind of lined it up. So went to go talk to her. I had about 3 days free to come up with a 45-second to 1-minute routine. I think that's what the requirement was at the time. Come up with this routine, clean it, perfect it, all that stuff, and go audition, like, within that week. So I talked to her on this is a Sunday. And so I may have had 4 days because I think it pushed over into the weekend. It may have been a Friday, Saturday. Can't remember, but it was a 2-day process for sure. But I had about 3 or 4 days to get this stuff ready. And for me to have been out of dance for a couple of years, that intimidated me. I felt like I only have a few days, and anybody else that's already known about it, they probably had a month or 2 months to get ready for this audition and all that stuff. But anyway, I got my routine together, went up there, auditioned. So the first day of that audition basically was us learning prances, struts, things like that. And if you don't know what a prance and a strut is, I'll place a clip somewhere in the video of what a prance and a strut is. But it's basically those cute little sassy walks that you see mostly HBCU dance teams do in a parade or walking into the stadium for the game, things like that. So that was kind of the first day. We learned some struts, prances, some stands, I believe, and then of course the choreographed piece that we actually had to audition for or audition with. So the next day was the actual audition, and so we auditioned. It was nerve-wracking, of course. All auditions, you're always nervous and scared, and what are they gonna think, and did I do good enough, and what if I forget the routine? All this stuff goes through your head. But auditioned, made the team. Made the team, y'all. I'm silly. I'm really silly. But made the team. This was a really rough year as well. It always seems like, and I'm gonna talk about my beliefs and things like that, and how much I believe in God, and how I believe that our adversary is the devil, and he's our enemy, and how he tries to come and attack us with certain things. I had already been dealing with a lot of low self-esteem issues and things like that, which I did not know that that's what it was at the time. The only reason I know now is because I'm actually listening to a series by my pastor at Faith Chapel Christian Center in Birmingham, Alabama. It's a series about low self-esteem and how it's an enemy to us as believers. And he did this series about early 2000s or so, but he has it on a CD, and I listen to it while I'm driving in the car. But I know the signs and the symptoms. I had all of them. I had low self-esteem at the time when I was at A&M, even all throughout high school, all that good stuff. But yeah, so I struggled a lot, and I feel like every time that I've tried to do something dance related, there's always been an attack. So there was the pulling of the hamstring. There was the drama that kind of went on that deterred me from auditioning the next year in high school to, you know, continue on to dance throughout the rest of high school up to 12th grade until I graduated. Just a lot of different things that I allowed to affect how I thought about myself, my dance ability, all those good things. I feel like that's the enemy. God does not call us to be down on ourselves. He doesn't call us to have low self-esteem. That's not of his nature. That's not his character. And us as believers, we're made in his image. So there's no reason for us to be walking around with low self-esteem as a believer in God, in Jesus Christ, in the Holy Spirit. No reason, absolutely, whatsoever. But yeah, I kind of feel like there was another attack that kind of hit me that year of, well, really that semester, because I only danced with Maroon Mirage for a semester. I started partying a whole lot, and this is probably going to be a little bit weird for me to say as a Black person, but for me to be Black and to go to Alabama A&M, for some reason, for me, it was a culture shock, and it was a lot going on. You start getting exposed to different things as a freshman, you know, you're out there by yourself now, so it was just a lot going on at the time. Wasn't really taking care of myself mentally. I only was taking care of myself physically because I was dancing. Because our like fitness regimen for Maroon Mirage was insane. And Alabama A&M is called the Hill for a reason. It literally sits on a hill, and that was part of our workout regimen for Marin Mirage. We had to run up part of that hill 4 times. And then once you stop, you have to stand at attention. And that's very hard when your legs are shaking and all of your muscles are tired from running up and down a hill 4 times. But yeah, so a lot of things went on. I kind of got picked on a little bit while I was on the team. That's kind of expected coming in as a freshman. You get picked on, you get teased, you get hazed a little bit. Yeah. So that kind of happened. But with me having low self-esteem, it just didn't go over well. And I took a lot of things very personally, from the teasing, even if it was playful or whatever. A lot of things I allowed to hurt my feelings and things like that. And I allowed myself, my own negative thoughts, my own negative disposition and how I saw myself to basically cause me to quit the team. And what I'm about to say next is one of my biggest pet peeves. And I believe it is this moment in my dance journey that it is the reason why it's one of my biggest pet peeves. So I believe we'd already had that first performance and we had practice again because another game was coming up. We were actually getting ready to prepare for the basketball season for the following semester. So I think we only had that one game that we performed at. We had practice, I guess, that following week or so after that first performance. Everybody shows up on time. I'm the only person that didn't show up on time because I already knew what I was getting ready to do. So everybody's in practice clothes. I show up, I'm like in regular clothes. I got on some jeans, an A&M t-shirt, and a jacket because it was cold outside. But yeah, showed up to practice, pulled my captain to the side like, hey, can I talk to you for a second? And I basically told her that I was no longer going to be a part of the team. Yeah. And I knew at that moment that I made a bad decision. And going back to my biggest pet peeve, I dislike quitters. That is one of my biggest pet peeves, especially with me being where I am now in my Christian journey, my walk with God and things like that. That is one of my biggest pet peeves. I mean, unless it's life or death, anything like that, why are you quitting? Why are you quitting on yourself? And that's an indicator of low self-esteem as well. Just not believing that you can push through when there's opposition. And that's one of my biggest pet peeves to this day because of that moment, because I quit on myself and stopped believing in myself and stopped believing in my dance ability. And because of the teasing and things like that, and it was a lot to take in. And I quit. I quit the team. And it wasn't just that I quit the team. I didn't come back the next semester to A&M, period. I didn't. I had given up on myself altogether. But going back to the dorm, and like I said, A&M is the hill. So, and my dorm was at the top of that hill. So it's like levels to this hill. It's like a middle section and it's like a higher up section on the hill. And of course my dorm is at the top of the top of the hill. So walking back to my dorm, it's cold outside and I knew, and then, like I said, this is before I really knew who the Holy Spirit was, and fully understood his function and things like that and how he can speak to us and give us insight from God. He talked to me the whole way up that hill and it was basically like, you know, you made the wrong decision, right? Like you know you shouldn't have quit, right? And I knew it that very, I just knew it. And like I said, before I knew it was him, I just kind of felt like I was having my own thoughts, which I, you know, was probably a little bit of me as well. But to this day, I regret quitting that dance team because that could have been an opportunity for me to push through that opposition, grow and develop as a person, as a woman, all of that good stuff, but I didn't. I gave up on myself and that was that. So, and that's another thing about me and my Christian walk and my Christian journey and all that stuff. I now know the power of healing and forgiveness. I had to forgive myself because I beat myself up about that for a very long time, for quitting that dance team. So, all right, so we're gonna stop again in the story right here, and I'm gonna go ahead and cut this into a third part because I feel like the video is getting pretty long, so I'm gonna go ahead and cut it short here. But yeah, so thank you guys again so much for watching so far, and I'll see you guys in part three. Bye. It's STG.